Let us lift his name on high, celebrate his grace. For he has redeemed our lives, and he reigns on high. Great and mighty is he, great and mighty is he. Clothed in glory, arrayed in splendor, great and mighty is he.
Christ is our solid rock, amen? He is our only hope that we have in this life. All we can offer is sin. I mean, that's the reality. But that's why Christ died for us, to redeem us, to impute his righteousness to us, so that we can be saved and seen as righteous in God's eyes. Let's rest on that solid rock.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Darkness veils his lovely face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
One more time.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Broken down every wall. He is our peace. He is our peace. He is our peace. Who has broken down every wall? He is our peace. He is our peace. Cast all
presence of my enemies.
Though the arrow flies and the terror of night is at my door, I'll trust you, Lord. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. And I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are on my side. Oh, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are on my side. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. And I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. And I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name. And bless your holy name.
So we're going to sing Surely Goodness, Surely Mercy, right beside me all my days. Just going to sing it as a congregation, okay?
So, surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. And I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name. And bless your holy name.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to tell you that I love you, and I'm glad you're here. This morning, we're going to talk about our shepherd, the good shepherd. And can you hear the voice of the shepherd? It's important. It's so important. So we're going to start out, and we're going to stay in 23rd Psalm. Anybody heard of that one before? It's kind of a lesser known. It's not, you know. A lot of people don't know it. You know, it's the hidden deep meaning of the word, right? I remember when I was a kid that, you know, well, a kid, like a teenager kid, still a kid, when you'd stay up real late, you know, back when the TV channels would like shut off at the end of the night, you know, and they'd have like, you know, the broadcast day is ended. Where I come from in the deep south, you might hear a little bit of that every once in a while come out, you know what I'm saying? That they would have the 23rd Psalm come up on the screen. I mean, that's how big or popular that this scripture is. But, you know, it's interesting, and the reason that, well, the reason is the Lord. But I believe the reason that the Lord brought this up is when we were in class with Gordon, one day he brought up a verse out of the 23rd Psalm, and it just kind of touched my heart that we don't touch on the basic things. I mean, when we're little and when we're in upstairs in children's church, we get that good milk, that foundation of the scriptures, right? But when we're adults, we want to like, let me get into that heavy meat of the word, right? Let me dig into some heavy stuff. We don't always have to do that. And you know, the funny thing is even in the milk of the word, there's nourishment. Even in the things that you've heard all your life, there's such treasure. So let's go through, and I'm going to read this out. And if you've heard it before, you might want to read along. I don't know. It'd be good for you. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You know, when we sang that song a few minutes ago, that I actually asked Margie for that song because it ties in so perfectly, obviously, with what we're going to do this morning. But the rest of the songs that she picked out are so tied in to this message. And that, to me, it tells me that the Lord's working. It always touches my heart and makes me feel a little something special when the Lord just lines things up for something that you're doing for him. It touches my heart so much. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go through the 23rd Psalm. I'm going to stick on this slide, and we're just going to... No, I'm kidding. Like my brother Jack said, I got 37 slides, so you know we've got to get through those. And just to let you know, and I told Jackson I was going to, you know, hit him up for this, so I hope you're ready. If you don't like King James, let me know, and I will get Jackson up here to be the King James to ESV translator. I'm kidding. I think we'll be able to get through it all right. I'm on one slide at a time. There we go. So what I like to do is just take each of the verses and break them down, and we're going to go to other places in Scripture, because as I've, Brother Gordon and I go back and forth, and I love him to death, and one of the things that I've told him is my favorite commentary on Scripture is Scripture. The Lord speaks to his own word so well. And okay, for pastor, love you, brother. I do have some Charles Spurgeon in here, you know. It wouldn't be a sermon in here without some Spurgeon, you know what I'm saying? So we got that. So we're going to go back to Exodus for chapter 3, way back in the way back. But first, you might notice down at the bottom of the screen, I've added a little thing, and I've added that to each slide. And this is something that I really love, is the Lord has different, it's the same Lord, same God, has different names throughout Scripture that are for certain things, right? Like this one is that, and I just kind of applied these where it kind of made sense. So this one is Jehovah Rahi, the Lord is our shepherd. And this was, you know, back in the 23rd Psalm, this is David. He's pondering his relationship as a shepherd to his sheep and realizing that it's exactly the relationship he has with God. So it's just an interesting thing, and I'll kind of apply that as we go along. But I thought it was good. So now Moses kept his flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert, kind of like Rock Springs, the backside of the desert. But we love it. And came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord, who that? The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight where the bush is not burnt. And the Lord saw that he turned aside. God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And I love this. And he said, here am I. When the Lord calls, what do we say? Here am I. Sometimes this call is for something super scary. And that's right, you can look up, brother. I'm talking to you. When the Lord calls you to go into a place that you've never thought that you would ever go, but you just say, here am I. Amen. So, and he said, draw not nigh hither. See, I love my King James. Put off thy shoes off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Now, you notice in Scripture, a lot of times in the Old Testament, you'll see the phrase, the angel of the Lord. That has very special meaning, right? Whenever God has dealt with people, humanity, in the Old Testament, before he came to earth as Jesus, that was Jesus. A Christophany is what they call that, where Jesus appeared in the Old Testament to bring forth his word, to prepare the people, to do things in the world to prepare for his coming. And I want you to notice something here. Moses heard the voice of the shepherd. He didn't just keep walking. There's a bush on fire. Cool, I'm out. No. There's a bush on fire and it's not burning. There's something weird here. I need to go check this out. So that's when we see something that the Lord's doing, don't just keep walking. Get in it. Because that's where he wants you. Where he's working is the safest place to be. The safest place to be, brother. In the presence of God, in his will, no place is safer. I will pause briefly for you to find the next verse. We're going to go to John 10, 27 through 30. And you might notice that I don't know how many kids grew up in church. I didn't grow up in church. The Lord had to find me when I was a heathen through Michelle. She led me to the Lord. And I was full into heathenness. So I didn't grow up in church. So if you grew up in church, you might remember something called a Bible drill. We might have us a little Bible drill this morning and like jump through Scripture and go all over the place. So in John 10, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. So important. Are we his sheep? Do we know his voice? Do we hear his voice? And I will give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. That went over well with the Sanhedrin. With the priest of the day, that went over super well. Oh, well, he said that, so it must be right. It's good. We'll get behind this Jesus, and it'll be fine. No, that is not what happened. So, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So you notice at the bottom, Jehovah Jireh, you might have heard that one. The Lord will provide. We're going back to Exodus because, you know, there's a lot of Moses that points to a lot of Jesus. So we can switch back and forth. So in Moses 16, verse 8, and then we're going to do 13 through 15, Moses said, "This shall be when the Lord shall give you in the evening flesh to eat and the morning bread to the full. For the Lord heareth your murmurings, which ye murmur against him. And what are we? Your murmurings are not against us, but against the Lord." Sometimes we might murmur a little bit. Sometimes we might squawk about what's going on in our lives. Just remember that the Lord provided those things for our growth. Not easy things always. The Lord only provides the good things that make me happy. No. The Lord only provides me money when I ask for it. Not so much. The Lord provides me hard times to make me strong. And it came to pass that even the quail came up and covered the camp. And in the morning the dew lay around the host. And when the dew was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness there lay a small round thing, which small as the hoarfrost on the ground. And the children of Israel saw it, and they said to one to another, "It is manna." For they wist not what it was. And Moses said unto them, "This is bread which the Lord has given you to eat. I shall not want." God provides. In the wilderness, where there was nothing to eat, God made bread just happen. In Philippians 4:19, "But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus," riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Psalm 34, O fear the Lord, all ye his saints, for there is no want for him to him. Let's go again. O fear the Lord, O ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. The lion, the king of the jungle, the head predator, the number one. When other predators come into a territory, they got to go to the lion and say, excuse me, Mr. Lion, you mind if I hunt in your area? I'll stay out your way. I'll be way over there. It'll be fine. It's cool. Whatever you want, though. The lion's children suffer hunger, but we don't. And in Luke, in 12, 31 and 32, but rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. I love this. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Little flock. Victory Christian Fellowship, we're a little flock. But it's my Father's good pleasure that he gives you the kingdom. Not just, here's some bread, we're going to send some quail your way. The kingdom. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. You know, we talk about peace a lot, right? It's interesting then in the Jewish culture when people meet each other, they'll say Shalom, peace, right? And when they meet their brother or sister, their brothers and sisters, that's for you, Daniel. When they meet their brothers and sisters, they will say Shalom, Shalom, perfect peace. I'm trying. I'm scared to death, but I'm trying. So let us pray that Jehovah Shalom brings us that perfect peace. It doesn't say, the Lord our peace when things are going well. The Lord our peace, period. All the time. God is good. All the time. Exodus 3, 7 and 8. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt. It was not good times for the folks in Egypt. And have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. And I know their sorrows. And I shall come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out of that land into a good land. And a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey. Unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites. And the Hivites and the Jebusites, and it ain't going to be theirs for long because I'm going to bring my people there. That's going to be their place. Lord hears our cries, and he loves us. Isaiah 49, 8 through 10, and then 13. Thus saith the Lord, in an acceptable time have I heard thee. In a day of salvation have I helped thee. I will preserve thee and will give thee for a covenant to the people, of the people, to establish the earth and to cause to inherit the desolate heritages. That thou may go unto the prisoners, that I might say unto the prisoners, go forth. To them that are in darkness, show yourself. They that feed in the way and their pastures shall be in high places. They shall not hunger nor thirst, neither shall the heat nor sun smite them. For he that has mercy and hath mercy on them shall lead them even by the springs of water shall he guide them. Sing, O heavens, and be joyful, O earth. Break forth into singing, O mountains, for the Lord has comforted his people and will have mercy on his afflicted. Are you afflicted this morning? Not necessarily physically. Spiritually, emotionally, are you afflicted? God will have mercy on that affliction. Do you need comforting? God will comfort you. And he has, and he will. Break forth into singing, O mountains. If we weren't singing up here, you'd have to listen to White Mountain start to sing. And I've heard him sing. It's not that great. But, I mean, when Jesus came into Jerusalem on the donkey, and his people were crying out. the Pharisees came and said, would you, and I'm paraphrasing because I don't have this written down. I'm not trying to, like, misread a verse. But the Pharisees came up and told him to quiet them down. And he said, if they would not shout, the very stones would cry out of what was happening, that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. This is one of my favorite things. I love this. So just I'm going to say that from time to time, just to let you know I'm down with this. I absolutely love what the Lord is bringing through here. It's not me, it's him, and I'm so glad of that. Exodus 14, 13 through 16, and then 21 and 22. We're going to get into some heavy stuff in this light little set of verses that everybody's knew since they was little kids. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians who have seen this today, you shall never see them again, no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. The Lord said unto Moses, wherefore crieth unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. So set the scene. The children of Israel have just vacated Egypt and took as much as they could carry with them. The Egyptians were not happy about this. They were coming right on their tail. They were coming to destroy the children of Israel. Their workers that were making those bricks without straw and left, and now they're going to have to find somebody else to do all this work, and these Hebrew slaves were way better, so we're going to go destroy them. But God had other plans. But lift up thy rod and stretch thy hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon dry ground, and the waters were a wall upon them to their right hand and to their left hand. He leadeth me beside still waters, through a sea, still waters on my right hand and my left hand. Now, there's an illustration, and I talked to Margie about this. So when many, many moons ago, Rich came in and painted these curtains blue, and it's beautiful how you can see clouds in the curtains, right? I'm going to give you a little different visual, right? I love this. This is so good. Picture you are walking through the Red Sea. You see, and I tried to find a picture that wasn't Charlton Heston, just saying. But it's as close as I could get. So you see the shepherd that God has given you in front of you holding up the rod and the sea parting before you. If only we had a way that we could see what it would be like to have walls of blue next to us on both sides and have a visual of that. When the Lord brought that to me, I will never look at these walls the same way. This is us in the Red Sea, in God's will, following His leading in perfect safety. The still waters of the Red Sea on both sides. My Lord is wonderful. So we went early in Exodus. We're going to go all the way. So right turn, go all the way to the end of the Bible. Revelation 7. For the Lamb which was in the midst of the throne shall feed them and shall lead them unto living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Revelation 21, 6. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning of the end and the end. And I will give unto him which is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. Are you thirsty this morning? Are you thirsty for God's word this morning? Are you thirsty for the love of God this morning? Revelation 22, 1 and 17. He showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. And the Spirit and the bride say, come, let him that heareth say, come, and let him that the thirst comes. And whoever will, whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. You know, I joke that after my father passed, and he was a great fisherman, he loved those catfish. There was a big river, a big lake in Louisiana, between Louisiana and Texas, where I grew up. And he would fish that thing and come bring out the most amazing catfish you've ever seen. Since he passed, I've always joked that he's going to be sitting on the edge of that crystal sea, crystal river, pulling in catfish like you ain't never seen. See, that southern came out, you know what I'm saying? So now, Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Exodus 15:26 is not here, but I am Jehovah who heals you, both in body and soul. In body by preserving from and curing illnesses and diseases, and soul by pardoning sin. Are we sick this morning? He restoreth my soul. Psalms 51, verse 10 and 12, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold thee with thy free spirit. Do we need a clean heart this morning? That's a heavy one right there. See, there's heavy stuff in the light verses. Hosea, it's in the Bible, I promise. Go to the front in the table of contents. Starts with an H and ends with Hosea. Chapter 14, verse 4 through 7. I will heal their backsliding. I will love them freely, for mine anger is turned away from him. I will love them freely, for my anger is turned away from him. Not from us, from him. I will be as the dew unto Israel. He shall grow as the lily and cast forth his roots as Lebanon. His branches shall spread, his beauty shall be as the olive tree, and his smell as Lebanon. They that dwell under the shadow, under his shadow shall return. He shall revive, they shall revive as the corn and grow as the vine. The scent thereof shall be as the wine of Lebanon. Do you need reviving this morning? You know, I've always liked the expression that the church is not a museum for saints, but it's a hospital for the sinful. That's why we come. Not because we're perfect people and we need a place to hang out with people just like us. If you're looking at that, you need to go on down the road, because this is the wrong church for that. We are broken. But we have a Lord that heals. We have a Lord that loves us and restores us. Jeremiah 32, 38 through 41. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God. And I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever, for the good of them and their children after them. And I will make an everlasting covenant with them, and will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their heart, and they shall not depart from me. Yea, I will rejoice over them to do them good. And I will plant them in this land assuredly with my whole heart and with my whole soul. How strong do you think it is when God does something with his whole heart and whole soul? It speaks about fearing God. Should we be terrified? Should we run from his presence? We should respect God that's done so much for us. His sacrifice for us is the only way for us to see heaven. It's the only way that we can come to him. We should respect that so much that we can't think of anything to do but please him. His love for us should make us love him. Jehovah Nisi, the Lord our banner. The banner is understood to be a rallying place. Should we rally around our Lord? Should we follow his banner? He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Exodus 13. Going back to Exodus. Get that Moses. Love that Moses. 13, 17 through 18 and 21 to 22. And it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, let's peradventure that they people would repent and when they see war and they would return to Egypt. So the way of the Philistines was a close path. It was the way from Egypt to the promised land was not a long distance. It would not normally take 40 years to walk there. God led them in a way that they would appreciate that when they got there and would not immediately say, well, you know, I think it was better in Egypt. I mean, the whips were not that bad. Don't really need straw to make bricks. It's fine. Could go back. We got food sometimes. It's good. Let's go back. But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up harnessed out of the land of Israel, harnessed with everything they could get a hold of. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night. And he took not away the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. Led them in the way. Christianity has not always been called Christianity. In the time of Christ, it was called the way. So that's another picture, another looking forward to Christianity, what Christ would do, that we would follow him in the way. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. In Psalms 5:8, lead me, O Lord, in thy righteousness because of mine enemies. Make thy way straight before my face. Do we need a straight way in front of us? Do we get confused by lots of turns? That's the good thing about going to Salt Lake. It's a straight shot. You get on 80 and you're there. It's good. A couple of hours, but you know, we're used to that around here. Psalm 143, verses 8 through 10. Cause me to hear thy loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust. Cause me to know the way wherein I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Deliver me, O Lord, from mine enemies. I flee unto you to hide me. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. We can trust him. We are to flee into him to hide us. This is not an easy world. There is no good thing in this world outside of the Lord. So when all the crazy comes, all the bad comes, we can flee to him, and he will hide us under the shadow of his wings, the word says. So here is my obligatory, Charles Spurgeon. It's just part of it. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Doesn't sound too pleasant. Shadow of death doesn't sound too happy. Spurgeon says, to walk indicates a steady advance of the soul which knows its road, knows its end, resolves to follow the path, feels quite safe, and is therefore perfectly calm and composed. We can be perfectly calm and composed walking through the valley of the shadow of death. Observe that it is not walking in the valley. We're not staying in the valley overshadowed by death, but through the valley. We go through the dark tunnel of death to emerge into the light of immortality. We do not die, but sleep to wake in glory. Death is not the house, but the porch, not the goal, but the passage to it. It goes on a little further and says, and then it is not the valley of death, but the valley of the shadow of death. For death, in its substance, the thing that we should be afraid of or could be afraid of, has been removed. And only the shadow of it remains. Nobody's afraid of a shadow. For a shadow cannot stop a man's pathway even for a moment. The shadow of a dog cannot bite. The shadow of a sword cannot kill. The shadow of death cannot destroy us. It's a shadow. First Corinthians 15, 54 through 57. I have them up here if you don't want to look them up. I don't know if you noticed that. I got them right there. And they're up there too. They're here. 54, so when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying as is written, death is swallowed up in victory. This is corruptible. I am corruptible. All of you are corruptible. But one day we won't be. We will be incorruptible. We will no longer be corrupted. Death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then Psalm 116, 15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Death to us is a scary thing. Death to us is something that we fear our whole lives and try to grab every bit of life that we can. You know, I've often thought that once we see heaven, we'll wonder why we clung to this life so strongly. This life that we've been given is a vapor. We're here for a little bit and then we're gone. But we hold on to this like there's nothing else. We know there's more. And this is not comparable. I had not seen, ear had not heard a fraction of what waits for us in heaven. I have to check my notes and make sure, because the notes are like super big. And anyway, it's kind of inside baseball, inside church, I guess. Psalm 27, 1 through 4, the Psalm of David, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise up against me, in this I will be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what waits for us? Dwell in his house. Just wonderful. Wonderful. Psalm 46, 1 through 3, to the chief musician and the sons of Korah, a song upon Alamoth. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will we not fear, though the earth be removed, though the mountains be carried to the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. You ever wonder what Selah means? See that in the word all the time? It means step back, ponder what God has just said. Step back and think about what has just been delivered. So just think about that. God is our refuge and strength. Do we have to be afraid of anything? So we walk outside as we're leaving church today. We look over, White Mountain is floating and heading toward the sea. We can just say, well, that's unusual. That's an unexpected change of my day. Yes, Lord. All right. See you back tonight, Lord. We don't have to be afraid. So Isaiah 43, 1 and 2. We've made it through almost like the first half of four verses, so we're really getting there. You know, when there was a church that we used to go to down in Florida, that the preacher used to say, you know what it means when a Baptist preacher looks at his watch? Nothing. He would go from like 10 o'clock in the morning and you would be starving to death at 1 o'clock, 1:30. It didn't matter. time. You need to be feeding on God's word. You need to quit worrying about lunch. Isaiah 43, 1 and 2. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. Through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. And you notice at the bottom, Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. Is the Lord there for you today? Always, always. Whenever you feel like that you've become distant from the Lord, it's not him that moved. We tend to do that a lot. You know, the sheep thing, that's sheep. Matthew 1:23, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted God with us. Thou art with me. Okay, so this is a good one. I know it's all good, right? Genesis, Revelation, it's all good. So, thou art with me. Mark 15:38, and the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. Hebrews 10:19-20, we're going to get to that. Hold on. I know, but it's going to be good. Hold on. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holies by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. Ephesians 2:14, I know some of y'all are like, come on, slow down. Like, we got a lot to cover. We're only in verse 4. There's like two more verses to go. For he is our peace and has made a way and has made both one. Has broken down the middle wall of partition between us, has made both one. Jew, Gentile, made both one. There was a veil that was between us that we couldn't enter into the holy. Only the chief priest could do that. And there was a whole thing. The tearing of the veil of the temple signifies the opening of the most holy place to all of his children. The room known as the Holy of Holies was the innermost and most sacred area of the ancient tabernacle of Moses and the Temple of Jerusalem. The Holy of Holies was constructed as a perfect cube. It was a perfectly square room. There's not a lot of those in Rock Springs, so you don't know really what I'm talking about, but it's perfectly square, like all the corners square. Kidding to anybody, any of that's carpenters out there. Love you. The Holy of Holies was accessible only by the Israelite high priest. Once a year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the high priest was permitted to enter the small windowless enclosure to burn incense and sprinkle the blood of a sacrificial animal on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant. By doing so, a high priest atoned for his own sins and those of the people. The Holy of Holies was separated from the rest of the tabernacle temple by a big veil, a huge, heavy, thick veil, a heavy drape made of fine linen and blue, purple, and scarlet yarn that was very elaborate with these gold cherubim. The veil and the elaborate rituals overtaken by the priest were a reminder that man could not ceaselessly or carelessly or irreverently enter God's awesome presence. There was a whole thing about it. There was a whole way that it had to be done. The high priest had to have a rope tied around him and these bells on him so that when he went in, if the people outside didn't hear the bells anymore, that would indicate that the high priest had gone in unworthily and that he had been struck dead and they would have to pull him out because they couldn't go in to get him. But this great huge veil separated the people from God. Man, this touches you right here. But my Lord, my Jesus, when he died, he opened that veil. The veil was torn from the top to the bottom. It wasn't somebody that went in and started tearing it at the bottom or started cutting it. It was ripped from the top to the bottom. He tore the veil open for us that we could enter in. That wall that was between us is gone. He tore it down so that we could have access, so that we could come straight to him, that we wouldn't have to get a sheep and lug the thing all the way to Jerusalem, and it had to be just right and all of the things. We don't have to do that. The perfect sheep has already been sacrificed for us. So, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. So, the shepherd's rod was a short club. I'm half Irish. Think of a shillelagh, right? A little short club. Or in the South, we might call it a wampin' stick. If somebody needs a wampin', you know, you got to have a stick around. You never know. Just somebody may have a need. There's several times in my life I have needed a wampin'. I'm glad somebody had a stick. And then the shepherd's staff was a long pole with a crook on the end. You know what I'm talking about, right? The visual that you think of when you think of a shepherd, crook. And that was for guiding the flock and then bringing in lost sheep. That sound like anybody, you know, lost sheep? So the sheep are totally dependent on the shepherd for food, water, leadership, and guidance. That's the way we should be with the Lord. We should be fully dependent on him for everything. Now, I know when I went through boot camp, I was taught to be dependent on myself. The art of self-reliance. Landon knows what I'm talking about. We are taught to take care of things. We are taught to handle things, handle your business. It is totally contrary for us to have to depend on someone for everything. When we living in a household and we trust each other to take care of the things that need to be taken care of, it's difficult for us to just throw our hands up and say, I don't have any of this. God, you have to take over. I don't have any of this. I can't do any of this without you. But that's what we're directed to do. How hard is that? How hard is it to put aside your pride and your abilities and just say, God, I can't. Not without you. So, okay. I notice, and this is a cool thing. So, ready? Okay. We're going to add something real quick on the fly. It's like I know what I'm doing. So we are going to add a selfie. Because you know how cool those are. Everybody likes those. So, you ready? You ready? Okay. Now, I'm going to talk. You can talk among yourselves. I'm going to work on this real quick. So, the staff, or the rod, was a sturdy wooden stick that was used for protection. That was for God to protect his flock. The staff was, the hook on the end was, if a sheep gets into a weird place, they pull the sheep back out, guide the sheep to where they need to be. Oh, okay, cool. It's finished. You ready? Ready? Okay, ready? I hope you're ready, because I'm not ready. Selfie time. Boom. Oh, wait. That's right. You know, it's weird. In my pictures, I have more hair than I have in real life. It's just funny. That is us. And while my brothers and sisters, I love all of you, and I appreciate the fact that you're laughing at me, but you notice that there's others in the background. That was the selfie that you... And there's a black sheep back there in the back. I don't know who that is. So the rod was God's strength and protection. Exodus 14, 15, and 16, and the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me, speaking to the children of Israel, that they go forward, lift up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea, divide it, and the children of Israel shall go through on dry ground. That was his protection. That was God's strength. He was already guiding them with the pillar of smoke and the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. That was his guidance. His protection of them was to set these walls of ocean to them so that when they went through, it would swallow up the Egyptians. Samuel, 1 Samuel 17, 34, 35. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went after him, smote him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he rose again, I caught him by the beard, and smote him, and slew him. With a rod, with a stick. I think he might have had a little help. Because I don't know too many lions that would take a coming up and grabbing them by the beard. I mean, that'd make them madder than they were already. And then, you know, take them out. Thy staff comforts me. It's God's guidance. Matthew 18, 12 through 14. How think ye? If a man have 100 sheep, and one of them is gone astray, doth he not leave the 99, and goeth into the mountains, and seek that which is gone astray? And if it be so that he find it, and verily I say unto you, he rejoiceth more over that sheep than the 99 that went not astray. Even so will it be, it is not the will of our Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. He was rejoicing over me because I was lost a lot. I was astray pretty regular before he came and got me. And it's not beyond me to stray now. I mean, I can do dumb stuff just as well as anybody else. Thou preparest a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. Exodus 12, 1, 3, 5, 11, and 12. Instead of bouncing around, we can just read it up here. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, speak ye unto the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of the month they shall take unto them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. The lamb shall be without blemish, male of the first year, shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. Thou shalt eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, that ye may eat it in haste. This is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Israel this night, and I will smite the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. I am the Lord. And then it goes on in 12 and 26 and 27. Then the blood shall be unto you a token upon the house where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. The plague shall not be upon you to destroy you. Then I will smite when I smite the land of Egypt. It shall come to pass when your children shall say unto thee, what mean ye this by this service? Kids don't understand sometimes. They just know that you do a thing once a year and we have really good food, but we have to like be all dressed with our shoes on and ready to go out the door. Doesn't make any sense to me. So we need to explain those things. We need to bring those kids up. They shall say, it is a sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when he smote the Egyptians, delivered our houses, and the people bowed their head and worshiped. We should remember that the blood was why he passed over the children of Israel. You know, it's sometimes I think that we can get a little weird about the blood, because we talk about the blood a lot. Sometimes if you just like take a step back out of church and you think about people that talk about blood all the time, it may be a little disconcerting, but that's not this. The blood sacrifice is important. It's critical. It's without the sacrifice of blood, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. So John 6 and 35, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. He prepares a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. Matthew 26, and as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them. Drink ye all of it, for this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. So there's a song, I'm not going to sing it. I might break out in a song, you never know, that we sing in a church back east. It's called Written in Red. And it talks about you ever notice the red text where Jesus speaks in the Bible? That some Bibles have it, some Bibles don't. but it's in letters of crimson, God wrote his word on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died, and love's greatest story was told. Down through the ages, God wrote his love with the same hands that suffered and bled, giving all that he had, giving all that he had to give, a message so easily read, I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you, I love you, written in red. Y'all gonna make me cry. Thou anointest my head with oil. In Exodus 30, 22, 31, this is Moses again, good old Moses. Moreover, the Lord spake to Moses, saying, take thou 300 spices, or three principal spices of pure myrrh, 500 shekels. And these are weights, right? Because we think of shekels as money, maybe. This is a weight. 500 shekels of sweet cinnamon, half so much, 250 shekels. Sweet calamus, 250 shekels. Cassia, 500 shekels. After the shekels of the sanctuary of olive oil and nin, it's about a gallon and a half. And thou shalt make the oil a holy ointment, an ointment compound after the art of acopathy. Apothecary. There it is. Close to it. Anyway. It shall be a holy anointing oil. So this is expensive stuff. This is not just some 30 weight. This is not just some olive oil. This is not just a base thing. This was something that had to be very carefully prepared because it was anointing unto God. And thou shalt anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them, set them aside for God's work, that they may minister unto me in a priest's office. And thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, saying, there shall be a holy anointing oil unto me throughout your generations. Luke 7, 36 to 38, and 41 and 42. I know there's a lot of verses, but God's word is so good. We should spend as much time as we can in the word, and I'm guilty of not doing that. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. I love this story. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, that would be all of us, sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, very expensive, and stood at his feet behind him weeping, began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with ointment. And Jesus tells a parable, because he often did that. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 pence, and the other owed 50 pence. And when he had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them loved him most. If I owe somebody 500, and they just wipe it out, I'd be pretty happy. And then in verse 44 through 47, he turned to the woman and said unto Simon the Pharisee, seest thou this woman? I have entered thine house. Thou gave me no water for my feet. Water for my feet. And she has washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gave me no kiss. But this woman, since the time I came in, have not ceased but kiss my feet. My head with oil did now not anoint. But this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But with whom little is forgiven, the same loves little, loveth little. My cup runneth over. And I know the sermon's running over. It's going to be fine. Siam King stays open. It stays open like all day. James 1:7. And every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Not even a shadow of turning. We saw before what a shadow. Not even the inkling of a turn. He doesn't ever turn away from us. Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. How many of your needs was that again? One more time. Yeah, I hear better out of that here. Thank you. All. Deuteronomy 28. Yeah, we was going to get to Deuteronomy. You knew that. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure. The heaven shall give the rain unto the land in the season, and bless all the work of thine hand. Thou shalt lend unto many nations and shalt not borrow. My cup runneth over. Now you're about to see something that's going to make you very happy, but we're not there yet. That's verse 6. There's 6 verses. Got to make those into 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Psalm 30, 11 and 12. Thou hast turned from me my mourning into dancing, and thou hast put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness. To the end that my glory shall sing praise unto you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks unto thee forever. Well, how long are we going to give thanks for? Forever. Forever is so big they had to break it up into 2 words. No? I thought that was pretty good. Psalm 36, 7 through 10. How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Wherefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house. Shall make them drink of the rivers of thy pleasure. For in thee is a fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. O continue thy loving kindness to them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart. Thou shalt make them drink of the rivers of thy pleasures. You know, it reminds me of the verse that says that we are to. It reminds me of the verse, and then it takes the verse away so that I don't remember it. You know, you should write these things down. They've got this whole thing called notes. Put all this stuff in the notes. That we should move on to the next one. Come see me later. I'll find it. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 73, 24 through 26. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but thee? There is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For we know in 2 Corinthians 5:1, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made of hands, eternal in the heavens. And this one I'm sure you've heard many times before, John 14:2. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us, a place in heaven for us, one of the mansions in his Father's house, in our Father's house. Do you live in a mansion right now? No? No? Nobody? Man, that's unfortunate. I wanted to look at a mansion today. We'll have to wait, I guess. But we have one waiting for us in heaven. Psalm 27 and verse 4. There's only like 10 more to go, I promise. We're getting narrowed down to the end. The funnel is going down the right way. Psalm 27, verse 4. One thing have I desired of the Lord, which I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. I know it was in the slide before. It's fine. We can hit the same verse twice. God's word's good. We can hit it over and over. It's a living word. We can go back, read this back in 20 years. It'll mean a whole different thing to you. Lord, God's word is powerful. But think about that. House of the Lord, dwelling in the house of the Lord all the days of our lives. Now, is our life only down here? No. Just a short little time. A vapor, right? How many more days are we going to have in heaven? A whole bunch. If you look up eternity in the Webster's Dictionary, it says a whole bunch. That's what you have to look forward to. And that's where we should put our treasures, right? We should lay up our treasures in heaven, Because the treasures that we lay up down here doesn't work out so good. Can you hear the voice of the shepherd? Our Lord loves us so much. He gave us the Holy Spirit to be a comforter, that He could guide us into all truth. He speaks to us through His precious word. He speaks to us in fellowship with our brothers and sisters. The voice of the shepherd is all around us. We just have to listen. But we need to be one of His sheep. If we are His sheep, then we will hear His voice. Are you a sheep of my Lord? I am. You saw a picture of me. Fuzzy hair and everything. No. I love you all. And I'm so glad that as pastor has been in bloody old England for a little while, that he's given us opportunity to come and share the word with you. Thank you for everything, and I just love you with all my heart. Let's stand and let's pray. They're clapping for you, Lord. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity to come to your house and to worship you. Lord, please put this word in our hearts. As we leave here, let us ponder this. Let us selah and think about what you have told us. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share your word, the opportunity for me to get out of your way and let you work. Thank you, Lord, for all these that came. Please bless them. Please bless all those that were not able to be here this morning. Please bless all our brothers and sisters that are sick, in need, or afflicted. We love you, Lord, and we pray that you would just be with us through the rest of the day and the rest of the week till we come back to the appointed hour. In Jesus' name, amen.